morning. As we all know, traveling in Hampton Roads is a challenge, and this morning is no exception. There's an accident. Kenny Wright's being held up along with a number of other members of the commission. We have a majority of the executive committee here. So it's Ms. Crum's recommendation that we go ahead and start our meeting and go directly to the workshop agenda so we can get that started. Once we have a quorum of the commission and once Chairman Wright gets here, then we'll stop at the appropriate time and come back to the election of officers and what have you. So is that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I believe that's a good strategy to proceed.
Our first workshop agenda item this morning is Go Virginia, and we have with us Mr. John W. Wayne Wynn with us. W., welcome, and I'll let you take it from here.
Okay, thank you very much. You all have a busy agenda, so I'm going to be at warp speed, and you're going to have more questions when we finish the probably two when we start, but this will be the start of a longer conversation. And we wanted to expose you to it. Some of you, TDC, DNL, DACO, have had exposure to this in our formats. I'll give you a little background before we jump into this. The senior business community in the state has not been involved in economic development for years. Been able. And that's part of our problem. And we realized it. About 2 years ago, we said we've got to jump in the middle of this and try and help out. So this initiative is funded by senior business all over the state. In this community, just to give you a sense of it, Landmark, Norfolk Southern, Town Bank, Dollar Tree, Newport News Ship, Williams Mullen, Ferguson. I mean, the large companies decided this is something that they need to develop. And I've heard you all make that comment over the years, and you're right, we have not been as engaged as we should have been. The second background piece is, and I don't think this is preaching to the choir, Dillon Rule, the Hine Commission report 50 years ago, if you can believe, 1967, recognized we have some impediments that make it hard for you all. The system encourages competition, does not give you funding without competing. That's a bad system in the minds of business. We think we need more collaboration. We don't think there's enough money around to not collaborate. We see no appetite for increased taxes. And so as a consequence, this is all about trying to incentivize and encourage collaboration that is voluntary. No one has to do this if they don't choose or want to do that. So the system that exists that has forced everybody to some degree in silos, even taking a business from the next jurisdiction, and you all know it too well, that helps the financial base in one community, but it doesn't grow the economy one bit. In fact, it actually costs us a little bit of money because you pay to move somebody over. So this is all about trying to grow the economy for the whole state. The other thing just to observe in the beginning, we did a lot of work looking at other states. We have been lucky in this state because of federal funding that has floated us for decades. That trough, if you will, is slowing down. We're still in a fight like the Dickens to try and maintain everything we can in that and get consolidation, but it is clear it's going down. And even when you hear that unemployment, you hear from some people, that unemployment has gotten back to where it was before the recession, actually this week it has not. Those jobs that have been added 70 cents on the dollar. So the downdraft on the growth in our economy is very significant. You all know all that. So this is all about trying to find a bit of a different model to get our regions to focus on economic development in a different way, in partnership with business, higher ed, and municipalities, the feds, the states, to leverage these dollars and actually focus each region on their own priorities. So with that, let me jump right in there. So, let's see, let's go push right here.
Mr. Chairman, can we, is there any way we can turn up this mic for the speaker? It's very difficult over here.
I'm not sorry.
I'm missing these important points.
Can somebody turn this mic up?
Thank you, Tom. It's been turned up.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I apologize. Okay, so, Go Virginia, big word. Bipartisan. It's not bipartisan, it does not work. It good news is economic development generally is bipartisan. And you'll see later that we had endorsements from both sides of the aisle, almost all the senior leaders from both sides of the aisle. This is a game-changing idea in the sense that it's going to put an actual framework in place. This is not going to be civic folks showing up every other month and working on a strategic plan. This is a serious, sustainable framework that's going to have a business standard of performance with a lot of business people and a lot of your people working together to see how we can get some leverage. Now, one of the other things I will say to you, and this is all dependent on the collaborations we're talking about, there is collaboration that needs to be enhanced. And we're convinced, after a lot of work, almost a year and a half's work, that the only way this will occur is if the state provides the economic incentives. We see no history of voluntary cooperation to do this, and the system has actually worked against us in that sense because of the way it's evolved over the years. So that's what this is about. Now, you don't need me to tell you about the economic situation. You all know it every bit as well as I do. But I can't in my lifetime remember when Virginia was 48 anyway. And when the last few years, our actual rate of growth in this state, and you know, depends on how you want to characterize these things. It's not good, folks. We're not creating enough jobs, we're not creating enough good jobs are growing up. Military jobs here, by the way, take 2.4 times the average private pay job. So every time we lose one of those, it's just like we lost 2.5 private jobs. That's a serious problem in what we have. Collaboration. The state economy is nothing more than the sum total of every region. Every region. Really, there is a state economy. There are a few things that are big drivers. Yes, the military. Military is not everywhere in the state. This is all about trying to empower, really from the bottom up in each region to be better and to be incentivized to go against their priorities, their unique strengths and challenges. Now, you've heard me say about incentives from the state. The other thing I would say to you is that, well, let me blow through this because there's a lot to cover. The consensus in all this, this aligns with lots of other activities. I'm assuming most of you all are familiar with the governor's new Virginia economy. Top jobs, I was on that group for a couple of years, but we got legislation. It's all about trying to get more skin age employment workforce and aligning higher ed with that. The chamber's done a wonderful job in their blueprint. What's missing from all of that is an implementation strategy of the region. This is about an implementation strategy at every region. And I can promise you, none of us in business have any interest whatsoever in getting involved in just another platitudinal strategy. This is about changing outcomes, and that's the only reason, frankly, that our group has shown up in the way that they have. Now, this is important. There will be, and there is no place to change any layer of government, any new form of government, any unfunded mandates, any consolidations of government. It will stay the same. Because the beauty of the economy is the economy doesn't care about those economies. Businesses care about their employees, recruiting those employees, their customers, and taking care of them. And none of them, unless they're very small businesses, are confined to one municipal boundary. So it's important to understand this is not a regional agenda of consolidation or any of that sort of thing. It's just not that. Similarly, we are not proposing any new taxes. We believe that there are opportunities for efficiency if we want to go out. They can really make a big difference and frankly, repurpose some of those monies. Yeah, all voluntary. Nobody has to do anything they don't want to do in this. This is entirely voluntary. So it's important to know that that local economy and collaborative tools are going to be available. Now, you're going to ask me, what are your examples? These are the five areas funded. We'll have general fund. We will be in the budget. We've been assured we're going to be in the budget. This is about legislation. You all will take it up and decide what you want to do with it. Until there is legislation, we're working on the details. Right now, we're working with both the leadership in the House and Senate and the administration trying to work out the details on exactly how this would work.
First three categories are innovation, investment, improvement, general fund grants that would be matched. And it will be, of course, the process has to come out of the region. If the regional council says, yes, it matches the criteria, there will be objective criteria. There'll be a lot of business people involved in this criteria. We're going to try and take politics out of this. I just got to tell you, this is going to be a better ROIs in the economy. And the last two will be bonded and funded. The convention and infrastructure, you're aware, again, the General Assembly have to decide what they want to do in this, but the rating agencies have been pushing us to go with another major bonding issue next year, and there seems to be some appetite for doing that. So research and higher education, when you're talking about convention, infrastructure, supplemental things that will allow economic development to improve innovation zones, I could go through a whole list of things. On the first three, I'll just give you a couple of quick examples. Workforce. Just doing generic credentialing is not going to do it for business. We have decided, and this was an aha moment for us, that if the people that have a vested interest in the subject we're talking about, whether it's a cluster or a workforce, you pick it. If they're not at the table and willing to put money in, forget it. You're kidding yourself. If you look back at our history, we've done what we would call aspirational planning a lot. We don't want to do that anymore. We want to get people there that come. Aspirational is fine, but in the next 5 years, we need to create some activity and some jobs. So you'll see a number of examples, and I can give you, if we have time, a lot of specific examples of those. Economic development, you all probably know this, there is no shovel-ready mega site in Eastern Virginia. I'll repeat that. So when Volvo looked and wanted to come to this port, they couldn't do it. Why is that? It just shocked us in business. We thought somebody was responsible for that, to be honest with you. And no, turns out nobody. Not the state, not the region. Nobody works. We got this. That just doesn't work. And actually, there's some stuff going on with Chesapeake right now with the Williams family and some other friends trying to get something up that would be great. Because folks, we need advanced manufacturers. And with that port, we can leverage some stuff and do great jobs in the supply chain around it and spread all over our region. So those are just some examples. Now, let me show you this video.
If we are going to preserve Virginia's position as a global economic leader, we must open up new avenues for growth that are not dependent on federal government spending. To sum it up, we must build a new Virginia economy.
For the first time in a half century, Virginia is trailing the nation in economic recovery and job creation. We currently rank 48th among the states in economic growth. Steep cutbacks in federal funding for defense and other programs have exposed our overdependence on public sector and government contractor jobs.
13 of the top 20 employers are in the public sector. It's great that we have the defense resources and assets that we have, but we need to look to the future. We need to look to the possibility of more sequestration.
The only solution is for the state to provide a meaningful financial incentive that would motivate the localities, private business, and all education to work together to help the economies of every region.
We need to diversify our economy away from federal dependence. And we need to figure out the right solution for each region.
It's the region. That's the organizing unit for the economy. And those regions that get that are the ones that are best positioned.
The one thing that we really learned from the blueprint exercise was that it really is working at the community level. And I think Go Virginia really dovetails nicely with that.
While the initiative for private sector growth must come from within each region, the Commonwealth does have a vital role to play.
The state could accomplish a lot by providing seed money for strategic innovation in each of our regions.
We get approached with a lot of different programs, and this one intrigues us because I think the localities will basically feel like this is something that the state thinks is important, but we have a stake in it also.
The business community certainly has got to lead the effort.
together with local governments, but higher ed is so important in the equation.
We have really an obligation to develop the economy and be catalysts in this area, and we're taking that seriously.
Growing the private sector in each region will require literally tens of thousands of workers with industry-recognized credentials. We need to work together to invest in workforce training that meets the demand of the private sector.
The state's economic development resources should be used to encourage and reward those communities that get smart about economic development.
When one locality actually takes a business from another locality, it actually hurts the economy.
A real attraction to a company, because they know how unique it is for a large area to say, we are one and we're working together on certain programs.
What we're about is, end of the day, creating more jobs, higher paying jobs, jobs that sustain our economy and get us back to our position of the best state to do business in.
If localities work together, they can deliver services more efficiently and realize savings. Every dollar saved is a dollar that doesn't have to be raised with new taxes.
If you look at our state, at what we do for regional jails, as a prime example of how that can work.
All too often, various local governments have not cooperated at the level that we need now. I think what the state can do is provide the incentives for them to do this. It won't be mandates.
Mandates do not work very well. I mean, this country was formed on entrepreneurial spirit and self-initiative, and I think that that's what we ought to continue to foster.
The state should encourage inventions and discoveries by providing matching fund support for labs, equipment, and other research-related needs.
Well, I don't know that there has ever been a time that was more important for universities, research universities in particular, to be committed to economic development.
So I see higher ed, our research institutions, playing a vital part in working with, quote unquote, the new economy.
It's going to be how well our research institutions like Virginia Tech partner with the private sector. I think the state does have a role in being a catalyst for that kind of interaction.
Well, one thing that is particularly exciting to me is trying to leverage the intellectual property that we're generating every day on college campuses.
The state has to be strategic in its infrastructure investments. The focus should be on capital projects of regional significance.
It can be difficult for localities in rural areas to tackle large projects alone. One example of that is broadband. Go Virginia presents a unique opportunity for rural Virginia to scale solutions that we already know work in our communities.
I think the state can obviously incentivize a lot of these bottom-up practices that we can make this a long-term sustainable program. And I think it's also important to make sure that we repurpose some money. And the beauty of this program is, which I've not seen in other programs, is the regions are helping develop, whether the governmental or the college and business, they're helping develop the best strategies. They know what's best for their region.
The carrot has to be big enough so that everybody will come to the table and no one will be able to walk away.
Having a reliable state partner is something that will ensure success. We're all in.
That's, for me, what's exciting about Go Virginia, is it provides additional tools and additional partners for us to work with to get this job done.
And that's why I'm very optimistic about some successes, but it is going to take some time and some determination.
You have to set in place the kinds of foundation pieces that are necessary. We're fortunate to go for children, the business leaders are at the table at the beginning.
They're in it for the long run. It's one of the most selfless things I've seen in my 24 years in the Senate.
This is not a sprint. This is going to be a marathon. This will be a long-term process.
If we can get regions to cooperate as a matter of course, nothing will hold Virginia.
So I'm going to stop there. I know you all have a busy agenda. Bob, I'll take a few questions if you want. This is, I apologize, it is quite complicated. There's a process in place that's being negotiated with, as I say, the General Assembly leadership and the administration. In a couple of weeks, that will be clearer, and we can start seeking your input, and does this work for us? And Bob is with us, of
to help us figure out these things on your behalf. All those of you that are interested in various aspects, welcome. We're going to need, this is not going to be a small number of people. We're going to have to empower a lot of people to get this done. But this time, we don't want this to be a civic project. This is serious. This is about the economy. This is about the future of our region and jobs and keeping our kids and grandkids in this community without food. So this is economic development and writ large, and I would welcome any of your comments. I will say one last thing, because you'll see Debbie and I chair the Community Foundation, and Debbie Croce is our CEO. Side by side with this for the last 2 years, we have been working on putting a structure in place that would allow us to take advantage of this system from the state. And again, the next step is to open that up to a lot more input. Remember, the legislation will be passed, if it's passed with the budget until July, and there'll be some period of time after that. But each region is going to have to stand up an organization that's serious about this, respected and coordinated with all of you, to get our high priority projects done. So, with that, Bob, should.
All right, thank you, Mr. Wynn. Mayor Hall.
Yeah. Thank you, Bobby. I really appreciate this. And I guess my first question is, as an economist, I always like to follow the money. So could you give me some idea of what you anticipate, if this is created, how much annual funding it might be? Secondly, sort of where do you see that coming from? Is it going to be new money, or are other programs going to give something up for this?
Yeah.
And finally, if it passes, when do you see this coming into operation?
They're all great questions. We told them, unless they, and I can speak, some of you can speak about this, unless they were willing to consider $25 or $50 million in general fund to start in the first 2 years, we were not interested in getting involved. Now, what they come up with, okay, the first year in fairness, Hampton Roads is the only region that is really ready to fund it. That thing is adopted. When we get everybody geared up here in the next 6 to 9 months, we actually will be ready to apply for some grants. It will take a lot for everybody else. So, and some of you will know, they're going to require, as they should, that each region do a study to identify the high priority opportunities. And two other things, the gap in the workforce that exists to maintain their existing workforce, and a cluster analysis that shows the gap they're going to have if they're serious about those clusters, to have that in there. So all of those are good predictors. That'll take, you pick the time frame, 3 to 6 months in every region to get that. The Community Foundation's already invested $1 million to get these studies done. So we'll have the raw data that you all can then start reacting to and ramp up. So that's one. The second piece of this relates to bonding. And this bond, you know, some of you know more than I do. I am told North Carolina just did a $2 billion bond issue, right beside the same size state. If we did less than $1 billion, it would surprise me. It wouldn't surprise me if we got as high as two. But the General Assembly and the government decided that. We really have no influence on that. Everybody has been told in higher education that this time is going to be economic development. So just building a classroom that is unrelated to STEM age or anything, or an innovation zone, everybody's been told. Now, who's heard? So the bonds will apply to the last two items. Bonding items. And then you asked, I'm sorry, your third question was timing.
Yeah, if this passes the General Assembly, how do you see it being?
Yeah, we're going to the Community Foundation. We have a CEO business roundtable that you all probably know about. It's got our senior business leaders put in place a couple of years ago. We're going to stand up, reinvent Hampton Roads, and fund it for the first year starting in January, ahead of this thing. So that we'll have a. And then we'll start reaching out and getting everybody involved that's appropriate on various subjects. So we're going to fund it on our own back before we see if there's any funding, because we think we need a running start. General Assembly said, you know the way that works. July takes a lot of dollars to flow. I mean, it's the odds, in truth, the odds of spending $25 million in the first year is about zero. And they'll all recognize that, and so they'll come back and we'll talk, because you know, there'll be a lot of pressure on them to fund things. You asked about repurposing. What is interesting is because of the organizational structure of this and the fact that we talk about outcomes and metrics and objective criteria to recommend these things up for funding to a state approval group, all of a sudden, particularly the General Assembly, is saying, well, you know, we've got all these other things going on. Maybe it ought to fold into that. So I think some repurposing
is going to occur against this, which will leverage us up a little bit more. I mean, I would, as an example, I just talked to Ron Miniger, bioscience, it's a cluster of governors talking about. We're having a lot of conversations and how that could be part of this. And but each region won't have assets to do bioscience. So it has to be, you get it, you see what I'm saying.
Thank you.
Let me ask you, you know, a couple of years ago, we tried through the Hampton Road Partnership, the first yep. phase of this, yep. shared services, yep. and what role do you see the PDC playing in this, and how do yep. we keep our arms around this so we're making sure that we're making a net gain and yep. And doing what we expect of
it? Yeah, great question. Kenny saw this right at BML. He was there and got to see this a time ago. I was the first chair of the partnership. The reason it failed is the state, and you all know this, reliable partner or unreliable partner, they cut out funding. Okay? For the Regional Competitiveness Act. The most they ever put in was $10 million across the whole state. The business community was not advocating for it. You all were not advocating for it at the same time. We the people, that because we had to go to a dues structure. So least common denominator thinking ended up debating because we had 100 people at every meeting. Doesn't work that way. You got to specialize and get the people that really know what they're talking about in the subject areas and get them working on these things. So we're not going to repeat a partnership. I mean, that's because none of us want to get involved with it, to be honest. The partnership was well intended. It just didn't work because of a lot of different reasons.
I agree. Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. Mr. Shepard.
An honorable notion to not have politics involved in this. We can always dream, right? But the reality of these regions and the application process, have you given any thought? You know, generally, a lot of times what we do, even with transportation issues, we look at a locality, we look at a region, and we look at multiple regions.
Yeah.
How in your vision for this program,
yeah.
do you see these regions, multiple regions, kind of reverse, multiple regions, a region, and a locality applying for
yeah.
money? But the key part of this, remember, we represent a mix of jurisdictions, and so there must be some, I hate to say this, but it gets political real quick, cost sharing, if you will, and not only cost sharing, but revenue sharing into those regions. I don't know, but how do you see these applications?
You do know, that's quite right. So here's the process. You can apply any two or more municipalities, not the region. We're structuring this because, look, we've got to walk before we run in this. We're trying essentially to create collaboration that hadn't been much of. We're hopeful that the dollars and the efficiencies and the obvious opportunity sets will have people start to come together and say, you know, we ought to do this. There's actually some stuff going on right now about efficiencies between three of our cities where they're talking about a pilot project, which would be great. It's a pilot project. So two or more, remember it starts voluntary, two or more. There will be a set of criteria about the significance, the relationship of this to the highest priorities in the community, the ROIs that exist on this compared to any other application. There will be a regional council against that which will certify up to the state that these match to our priorities, and we think this is a worthy project you should fund. Then, of course, there's a state commission that will say yay or nay on that criteria. For the most part, that criteria is coming out of the region. Now, let me just give you, I apologize on this, because the devil is in the details. Three levels, the money will be split in three ways. One level will be a minimum amount that go to stand up an organization in each of the regions, so that there can be substance to this and continuity of effort. The second piece, maybe 40%, will be per capita to stay within the region. 50%, more or less, will be for the big ideas across the state. So as an example, let's say that Hampton Roads decided it wanted to target in Northern Virginia on something. Cybersecurity, as an example, or some such. That would get a huge credit because it goes even beyond a single region. It would be a multi-region that could help something significant. So it's that kind of logic that would apply in doing this. And but the truth is, you know, we really have to walk before we run. And so it's finding these projects that everybody says, well, you know, this is low-hanging fruit. I can't afford to do this by myself. If I do it with them, it'll be a good thing. I see a linkage. I see an impact.
And we hope over time, trust will start to come into this, which has not been the case for a long time, we know that, and start to do more and more. But we're gonna have to have some early successes where you all buy into the fact that this is worthwhile. Now, we don't spend the money here, the money will go to the rest of the state, just like it goes to transportation.
Dr. Ward.
Good morning, and thank you for the presentation. And as you detailed your five priorities and agenda references, especially under innovation and invention about funding for higher education, and you know, the challenge really in our Hampton Roads area has been in recent years the funding for K-12 education that has really dwindled at the state level, and we certainly are, you know, suffering the consequences of that. How do you see this goal, Virginia, with respect to trying to restore funding for K-12 education and workforce development? How do you see you planning that?
What we've decided, we're about economic development. So this is not about the environment. This is not about K-12 funding. It's not about the homeless. We're focused on economic development because we think a rising tide floats all boats. This economy is weak. The people who suffer the most are at the bottom of the food chain. And we need to get this economy going. And so our objective is to get it going in the next 5 years, not in 10 or 15 years. As an example, I happen to be a big advocate for early childhood. I've always thought it was sensational, thought we should do more and more. I'm a big advocate for funding K-12. But you're gonna hear from some of the legislators, and I don't know the facts on this, you would, you've got a history of this, that there may be some collaborative opportunities to become more efficient across school districts, not change control or any of that. Monies can be redeployed. Now, some of the experts, Kirk Cox and others, have done studies on this. I don't know the details of that, but clearly, it's in the Constitution, clearly K-12 is important. Now, I will say one of the projects that we are vetting now in Hampton Roads is trying to see if we can do a regional school for what they used to call trade schools. 9-12 can create a world-class regional opportunity set that will link up with business so that the internships, not just doing something hoping they get a job, linking it. So like Duke News is an apprentice program and that sort of thing. Then have best practices out of this regional that can flow into every school system that's interested. That's leverage. And we really need to do so. That's our piece, but it relates to the economy. And, you know, we're all CEOs. Focus is our deal. If we get spread too thin, we won't get anything done well. And so we think right now the number one priority for us is to get this economy moving.
Thank you, and I certainly heard the apprenticeship programs and getting students ready. Businesses want that, and we've got to get these high school students ready to go into even higher ed or into the workforce. And so rather now we are aligning with businesses with more apprenticeships, more training, more technology. That's so important, and I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, and frankly, the other thing we've got to start celebrating is a culture of people that go into trade jobs.
Absolutely.
I mean, Germany's done it forever. Somebody makes $60,000 a year, and that's not a significant success.
Absolutely.
I can't believe that. So.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Nguyen. And hopefully we'll hear more of this to come. This is exciting. It is going to require some real frank conversation from all of the stakeholders here. Next steps?
Next step, well, we'd like your endorsement because right now we're trying to get a freight train coming downhill for the General Assembly and the administration so they know this huge support. We've already got 70 organizations across the state that endorse this. Almost every business organization in this region has already endorsed this. And whether or not that's appropriate, how do you do it to PDC? You asked me, somebody asked me
PDC role.
Bob is part of the group that in a couple of weeks will start convening. There'll be a half dozen of us, more or less, that would be working on the application in this region. So he will be your representative in terms of the overview. And then as we start to kick in the data that allow us to do more of these things, you all can start to tell us who are the right people to be involved in this. So that's what we're looking for.
Well, Mr. Chairman, if I may, just very quickly, in our draft legislative agenda, which is included in your agenda package today, one of the items we have on there as a priority initiative is PDC support for the Go Virginia initiative. with special request and consideration be given to the role PDCs can play in the process. So that is proposed in the legislative agenda. We'll be looking for formal action on that in November by this year.
So we'll have at least another month to have a little bit more conversation, which just really deserves it. I'm certainly in the field of I like it, but. Okay, thank you very
much. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely, thank you. And for the sake of time, if the board would not mind, we'd like to go ahead to item 7. I think the delegate to give us the briefing on the greenhouse gas initiative, and then we'll, and we may have to, Julia, put you on next month, but let's see how quick Ron here can get through his presentation. Go on, sir.
Good morning, Chairman, and ladies and gentlemen of the Square Table. How are you guys doing? I'm Delegate Golan Weber. For those of you who don't know me, I served as on the community city council for 7.5 years with some of my good friends here on the corner. In 2010, I was elected to the House. I currently serve on the Courts of Justice Committee. I'm a member of the Commerce and Labor Committee. It sits on the Manufacturing and Energy Subcommittees, and I am the leading chairman of Transportation Accounts. It's interesting following Gutting. We were just talking the other day with regards to, you know, regional initiatives, just coordination, and just to give you a framework of where we are in General Assembly. We, like you, we want to get some stuff done. Right. And with regards to Good Virginia, what we're finding out is, yes, it's a great template. We need to put the action plan and get it going. More importantly, we need to help coordinate and help redefine and repurpose. We heard that word earlier. Some of the monies that are there. You know, when you guys were talking earlier, I wanted to jump in and say a couple things. One is, you know, for instance, the folks in this room are familiar with our Virginia Values Veterans Program, I'm assuming. And what it is a big transition program for capturing our workforce, for transitioning veterans to put them back into the workforce and keep them here in the region. And what we did was we put monies towards a grant for employers to hire veterans. And, you know, listening to Dougie, what we've got to do is make sure we repurpose and make sure that it's coordinated with Go Virginia so that those folks that are in the military, for instance, we talked about cyber. Just the other day, I was with Councilman Davenport, the City of Virginia Beach, is leading the efforts on cyber protection. And truth be known, here in Hampton Roads, you guys know this, there are major military cyber commands here in Hampton Roads, but we don't advertise that. Need to capture what's there, and the industry is here already, but there's no coordination. And what we're telling everybody is there just needs to be coordinated efforts. I'll give you, for instance, at that meeting was K-12, academia, and the workforce, and we're talking about workforce development. K-12, there in Virginia Beach at the Advanced Technology Center, they're already training there. High school folks for certifications that the industry needs. And the industry, believe it or not, it's almost like, identifying a draft choice. You're gonna bring that person for employment, and that's what the industries are doing already. They're reaching beyond the current higher ed scheme, and they're going to K-12 already. So that's what's going on. But just to let you know, the effort's there. Talking to the Speaker House, he was here last week, and Majority Leader Cox will be here on Monday at Hampton Roads. We're going to put money towards Go Virginia, so I encourage the body to support this. Now, you know, we talk about politics, I'm following Dougie, and that's the reason why I'm before you, is because I'm pragmatic like you guys. Having come from local government, I get it. You got to figure out where the money's going to come from. That's the reason why. We're going to talk about coastal flooding and the regional greenhouse gas initiative. So, ladies and gentlemen, here we are. If you believe in the science or not, given climate change or global warming, whatever, bottom line, it floods, right? It floods in Hampton Roads, and we all know it. And Hampton Roads is ground zero for coastal flooding. And this is what's been done in the past, and this is what's ongoing. And as you know, we've got study commissions galore. Governor Kane started it. Governor McDonald had it. Governor McAuliffe has it. We've got folks that understand sea level rise. We know where the problem areas are. The bottom line is there's no funding. So, since, you know, part of Virginia Beach, part Chesapeake, here's an example. In Virginia Beach, as you know, we have over $100 million in mitigation costs for repetitive loss properties. I didn't put the other figure. Virginia Beach has over $1.2 billion worth of flood mitigation needs that are unmet. City of Norfolk, I've been adopted by City of Norfolk, I guess, because I'm caring about coastal flooding efforts. They have over $2 billion. City of Chesapeake has several $100,000 worth of flooding initiatives. And just to let you know, if you're looking for federal and state partners, they're not there. Sunlight, FEMA gives an annual grant about $725,000 for these efforts. And as you know, it's not enough. This particular property is in Lewis, if you call this in your district. Severe flooding along the river plains. They raised their property up. And that's what you're going to see. You're going to see that in Norfolk. You're going to see that in York County. You're going to see that in Cosin. You're going to see that all across Hampton Roads. And the reason why this effort's before you is because, just like transportation, it shouldn't take us over 3 decades to figure out how to fund these things. We have to figure it out of the box. And I know what you're saying. Why is a Republican carrying this bill? Well, you know, believe it or not, some of these initiatives came from our party, but it's more bipartisan. We knew Reagan, he led the efforts with regards to some market-based reforms, with regards to lead gasoline, HW, he led the acid rain program, sulfur dioxide from the power plants. And here's what I'm saying is, we have a clean power plant that's provided by the EPA. And politics or not, bottom line is, we all know we need to be good stewards of the resources. That's the reason, part of the reason why you guys exist, and the legislation you guys put in this, and the policy making that you guys help craft, is we need a solution. We need to think out of the box. And currently, in the North Atlantic region, we have what's called the REGI. And what the REGI is a market-based solution with regards to cap and trade. And it asks industry, you know, to help figure out the solution rather than putting an unfunded mandate out there. What it is creating competition and innovation, those things you need to hear in order to help propel these initiatives. So how does it work? Bottom line is, states under the EPA Clean Power Plan, what they do is set the standards for carbon allowances. Here in Virginia, as you know, we're not meeting those standards. So we're gonna need help. We could team up with other states nearby that aren't in this plan, or team up with North Atlantic group to figure out strategies. And what it does is, again, it creates business and it makes innovation, and the bottom line is it gets results.
We've got about 3 minutes.
Sir, I'm working. So here it is. This past session, along with myself and Senator McKeachin, we led the efforts just to put it on the table because, you know, we've been hearing about all these plans that there was no funding. So what our state plan does, and it's called the Coastal Protection Act. What it does, it hooks to capture $200 million annually. And here's the pot. This is how it's divided. It's in your flyer. What it does is, again, gives undergoing inland to geo-rise and flooding adaptation. It teams with the localities and the regions to figure out solutions, whether it be a seawall or a grant program for your homeowners, because bottom line is, when it floods, who do they go to? You go to the local government and ask for more money. And what it does also, it develops monies for efficiency programs for low-income and moderate-income folks that are having trouble with regards to paying their energy bills. And it helps to spur all these new clean energy, renewable industries that we keep talking about, and solar, and such. The bottom line, it's a pragmatic approach, because right now, in the General Assembly, there is no plan. Or the plan is to sue the EPA and fight them and prolong what we need to do, and that bottom line is to get results. So, again, the plan is develop some kind of regional mechanism to adapt to a clean power plan in the hopes of capturing monies towards coastal flooding, establishing and strengthening new industries, but more importantly, protecting our homeowners and our citizens. So, again, those are the main topics of why I'm here before you today. We've got good response from the state. It's been described, this plan's been described in every major newspaper in the Commonwealth. City of Norfolk's already passed a resolution. City of Charlottesville, this past September, I was with the City Council and Virginia Beach is putting it as part of their legislative packet. And I just got texted right now, the Virginia Municipal League is putting this in their legislative packet. And what's this doing? Bottom line, it's creating some good, hearty discussions on how to pay for this stuff. So I encourage the body here to help support this effort. If you've got any other questions, you know, I can brief you individually or come visit your city council. As you know, November 3rd is an election. I'm kind of busy, but before, I'm there for it.
Yeah, thank you very much, Debbie. Any quick questions before we move on? All right, thank you. And it looks like to the board, we're going to wrap up here at 10:30, and the chair has never been late at this time. I'm going to pass the buck and ask for a motion to be made to elect our new officers for this year. Dr. Clyde Holman as chair, Dr. Ella Ward as vice chair, Mr. Marcus Jones as treasurer, and Mr. Bob Crum, or Robert Crum, as secretary. Is there a motion to accept it? So moved.
Second.
And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Same right? Thank you. Mr. Chairman, the floor is now yours, and you have 8 minutes.
Well, thank you very much, Kenny. I'd like to start by first thanking Kenny for all his service, both to the PDC and other regional organizations. I chaired this organization for 2 years, the vice chair before that, and on the budget and personnel committee. You've been a real cheerleader for the PDC and its programs, particularly the Ask HR Green program. We appreciate that. And we appreciate all your service to the region and the forward work.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Also, thank you very much, and I look forward to working with all of you. Thank you. Back to our agenda. Since our agenda has been modified dramatically already, I'll ask if there are any other modifications to the agenda. Hearing none, I'll ask for an approval of the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, if we could we defer the legislative agenda to next month so we can get back on
our agenda?
All right, I move that we approve the agenda as modified.
Second. Everybody in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Executive Director report and employee recognition.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. First off, my monthly work status report is included for the board members' review and in the agenda. There are a couple of items I would like to put or highlight for you. First, you'll recall that a few years ago, all of the regions within the urban crescent, or golden crescent, from Northern Virginia through Fredericksburg, Richmond, and to Hampton Roads, met in a collaborative meeting to try to come together around the public, around funding for transportation within the Commonwealth. And many of you participated in those meetings, which resulted in, we think, a good movement and generated interest in the General Assembly for addressing the transportation funding challenge. We've been approached by representatives within our region and also from Northern Virginia about the idea of doing the same thing this year and focused around the topic of public education, K-12. The notion being that as state budgets continue to pass, the burden on local governments continue to increase, and the amount of state funding contributed to that effort continues to decrease. And that the idea being if we could come together as an urban crescent and have a conversation around this, then we might be able to have some success similar to the success we had in transportation. So I'll be reporting more to you on this idea as we move into November. And I did want to give the board members, Mr. Chairman, a quick heads up that those conversations have been issued. The second item I'll note is that we generally cancel the December PDC TPO meetings. What we're proposing to do this year is on December 17th at 10 a.m., which will be our regular meeting date, the PDC and TPO boards, we are proposing meet in joint session to hold the region's first annual legislative forum. And our idea is that we would be inviting all of our General Assembly members from the Hampton Roads region to join us that morning, along with our federal delegation. And it would be at that meeting that we would work with our board members to present our state legislative priorities for this year, as approved by the PDC and TPO, and also our federal legislative priorities as well. So, save the date, postcard or email will probably go out to all of you next week so that we can get that on everybody's agenda. Mr. Chairman, then, I do want to take a moment. We do have a PDC employee who's celebrating this year an anniversary. I'd like to ask Jennifer Coleman if she could stand up, please. Jennifer is the administrative assistant that provides staff support to the Planning District Commission, and she's celebrating her 5-year anniversary this year, Jennifer, with the Hampton Roads Planning District Commission. I think why it's important to recognize Jennifer is you see all of us here at these meetings at the podium speaking, myself, Randy, Camilla, and other principals. It's people like Jennifer behind the scenes, though, that really makes things happen. So all the agendas that you receive as board members, all the minutes you receive for these meetings, all the scheduling, Jennifer's the person behind the scenes that keeps us on track, keeps us organized. Her with the other team members here keep these meetings running on schedule and efficiently. So if you could please join me in a quick applause.
Thank you, Bob. That brings us to our regular agenda. You have submitted public comments, maybe none, as well as transcribed comments from the September 17th meeting in your agenda packet. And that brings us then to the public comment period. And I have one speaker's card, Mr. Ellis W. James. Mr. James, here.
Right here.
Congratulations, Mr. Chairman. My name is Ellis W. James. I reside at 2021 Ken Lake Place in the city of Norfolk. I'm going to appear to pick on my city a little bit, but please listen carefully to what I'm addressing. Just in case some of you didn't see it or notice it, we had a major storm and a near miss. I hope that the communities both the counties as well as the cities had a brief overview of the storm's impacts and especially those issues that address the flooding impacts that are so severe. In Norfolk, we had about a half an hour presentation from Jim Reddick on what the impacts were and what was accomplished. It was an excellent report, and it touched all of the bases that needed to be mentioned. There was one thing that got my attention especially. In a city of over 230,000 people, about 40,000 people on Twitter and social media and so on were able to be participants in the dissemination of information of what to anticipate and the dangers and the risks. I hope that each one of the communities, if you did not have an opportunity to do an overview, will please do that. My great worry at this point is we are entering in an El Nino year. We are entering now into the winter and the northeastern storms situation. We are not safe yet. And I would hope that each one of the communities would not be lulled to sleep because Norfolk didn't get flooded or Virginia Beach didn't get severely flooded and so on. If we pay close attention, we will be able to protect our citizens and our residents. And I would hope that each one of you who represent the communities will address that issue if you haven't had a chance to do so already. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our next agenda item is the approval of consent items. I have a motion.
So moved.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. We have the 3-month tentative schedule with keeping in mind Rob's proposal for December. Advisory committee summaries and correspondence of interest in your packet. Is there any new business? If not, I'll declare this meeting adjourned. 1 minute late.